r/AskReddit. Reddit, what's your family's dark secret? NSFW. I've told this story on here before. My mom's relationship with my dad was following a divorce. She had two kids with her first husband, a son and daughter. When she started dating my dad, as she was pregnant with my older sister, my dad molested my oldest sister. As soon as it happened, she found out about it. He tearfully confessed when confronted, told her he was sorry, and begged for forgiveness. She forgave him. He kept molesting my sister. Had my mom done the right thing, had she called the cops or even just left him, I would never have been born. Instead, I was the product of a child molester with an anger management issue, who tormented and terrorized my family until my mom left him, when I was 7. My oldest sister is broken. She's got borderline personality disorder, or perhaps narcissism. She has never had a healthy relationship with another human being. She is abusive of her siblings and none of us have a real relationship with her. I found all this out 17 years ago. It's weird to consider that I shouldn't exist, that I shouldn't be here, but it doesn't trouble me. I try to be a good person. I'm definitely not my dad. Edited to Adwell, this blew up. I definitely wasn't expecting that. Thanks, kind stranger, for the gold. To add a bit of context, surprisingly, only one person even asked. No, my oldest sister is not my mom. She was only 7 or 8 when I was born. For the people offering support, thank you, but I'm good. I'm a happy person. I sometimes have anxiety, but it's mostly related to the state of the world we live in, not my family background. I work in education. I'm more than aware of the statistical improbability of any individual's existence. That I shouldn't exist, if my mom had exercised good judgment doesn't affect me. I'm here, so I try to be good. Everyone should try to be good, regardless of the circumstances of their birth. I'll add one story about my family that doesn't really change anything, but maybe it will give some of you the illusion of resolution. When I got married, my sisters were the maids of honor for my wife. My brother was our photographer. As we were ramping up to the wedding, my oldest sister began acting erratic. She got into a fight with my brother, typical, and laid down an ultimatum. It was him or her. She did the same thing with my dad. She didn't want to be in the same place as him. So I called her up, and we had a talk. I basically spelled it out for her. This was my wedding. It was going to play out the way I wanted, and she was not to make any ultimatums. If she said it was either her or my brother, then she'd be out. It's that simple. When I told her that, she immediately dropped her protests of my brother's presence, because, going back to a point I made in one of the other comments, I'm not in a position where she can hurt me emotionally anymore. I don't put up with her shit. But as far as her ultimatum about my dad, well, him being at my wedding, and her bailing on it, because he was there, felt too much to me like an example of the bad guys winning. I told her that I had no problem disinviting him from the wedding, and that's exactly what happened. From that point, on occasion, when I'd see him, he'd complain about it, and when he did, I basically said, "You're lucky we have any kind of relationship at all, because you don't deserve one. I wouldn't push it, if I were you." And he dropped it. That was that. My dad basically took a life and wrecked it. He should have no reward for that. And the person with the wrecked life, she's now in her 40s. I know, factually, that people can get help for their problems. If she ever does that, I'll be there for her, but I can't force her to do it. Maybe someday, in time, but I'm not counting on it. My paternal grandma got pregnant with my dad when she was something like 17 in a small town in northern Louisiana. She claimed my grandpa was abusive, so she and her sisters took her for New Mexico when she was 19 and my dad was a little less than 2. On the way she surprise delivered my uncle who bears little resemblance to my dad, obviously mom is same. She then very openly carried on an affair with her 60-ish year old boss, until she met my step-grandpa. He was a great guy, raised my dad and uncle, as if they were his own. As the story goes, step-grandpa is overjoyed when grandma gets pregnant with his baby, but my aunt comes out bearing a remarkable resemblance to grandma's boss. Hello. Boss's wife shows up to the happy house with a gun and a checkbook. Says she's using one of the other to get my grandma to go away. So in like 1961, my grandma gets a check for something like $10,000 and she and step-grandpa buy a brand new house. All good, right? Nope, grandma had innumerable more affairs, was married twice more, and my step-grandpa felt so betrayed. After he raised all three kids, he committed suicide. Grandma tried to swoop in and take over his social security survivor benefits somehow. Right before grandma died a few years ago, she kicked her last husband out, cleaned out by a joint savings, and she and my aunt and cousins took off for Arkansas. Right after I was born, my real grandpa shows up on our doorstep with literal boxes full of letters, birthday cards, newspaper clippings of my dad's activities like sports, and getting his PhD. Grandma had gone through all of them, and taken the cash and checks, and kept them for herself, and just to be cruel returned the remnants. Turns out grandpa was a great guy who was never abusive, missed his son like crazy, and was always working blue-collar jobs, so could never really get away. Grandma actually bolted when she was 19, because she'd had an affair with the local book salesman and his wife came only with a gun, no checkbook. Edit, wow, this blew up, little worried to check the comments. I guess to add, my grandma was very sweet to me, and before I knew all the inside drama, I just knew her as a very attractive older woman who smoked a lot but otherwise was a pretty typical grandma. She was also a great mother-in-law to my mom, and one of my brothers has severe autism and my grandma was amazing with him. So she's very much a mixed bag depending on who you were in her life. I was a little hurt when she took off for the last time because she cut my dad and his family completely out, and we don't know why. We only heard she died from my great aunt. From the pictures I've seen, she was stunningly gorgeous. Had she been born a millennial, she'd have made a perfect Instagram influencer. So I think getting men to do her bidding came very natural to her. My grandma had always told me my grandpa's mother died when he was very young and his father couldn't handle him, so that was why he was raised by non-relatives. My sister and I did a little digging, and come to find out my great-grandma was only 15 when my grandpa was born, and my great-grandpa was in his late 20s. From what we can tell, her family forced her to marry her abuser. She also didn't die when my grandpa was little, she died when my dad was a teenager. She just took off and left her unhappy situation when grandpa was a kid and never tried to see him again. Then his dad basically left him on the neighbor's porch in the night and took off and had two more kids with another significantly younger woman. I think my grandma told us great grandma had died to make my grandpa seem more sympathetic, because he was a mean old bastard and none of his grandkids cared to be around him. My grandpa also continued the cycle of child abandoning. He knocked up his first wife just before he left for military training, and when he got back, he said the kid, who she had named after him, wasn't his and kicked them both to the curb. My grandma knew that Junior was his, and she used to secretly send the first wife money when she could get away with it without my grandpa knowing. He tried to do the same thing to my grandma when their first child was born, but her family literally held him at gunpoint, so he signed the birth certificate. He claimed both their other kids. My dad was his favorite and the only son he acknowledged, but he always swore my uncle was not his and none of his kids with my grandma ever met their older half-brother or his kids. My grandma once told me she had hated her husband for almost their entire marriage, but she didn't know what to do besides stay with him. It broke my heart to know she spent so much of her life so unhappy. She is such a sweet woman, and didn't deserve the way he treated her. I'm pretty sure my uncle was in the Hells Angels, or at least affiliated with them. His funeral was interesting. The procession to the cemetery was loud and proud. Edit, I'll give a little more detail about him for you guys, since this thread got so popular. I've been told he was a great mechanic even in his teenage years. There's a story of how he took a car completely apart and all the parts were laying around my grandmother's backyard. Grandma told him that she would give him $100 if he could put it back together again and get it running, and he did. Also, that would have been the late 60s, early 70s, so $100 was worth a little bit more back then. He even had his own repair shop at one point. He was a motorcycle drag racer, and quite popular with the ladies. At his funeral there was a line of ex-girlfriends that came to cry over him. All of my uncles were bikers, but I think he's the only one that became an outlaw type. I guess you could say he was the black sheep of the family, however he was loved by everyone. I only really saw him on holidays, and I was only 12 when he passed away, so I didn't really get to know him personally. My mother would tell me stories of how he would pester her to no end when they were kids. He would hide under her bed until she fell asleep and yank her off the bed. Then other times he would hide outside her bedroom window and shoot her with his BB gun. My great-great-great-grandfather, Mike, was a complete psycho. He and his wife, Mary, had 10 kids. 9 girls and a boy. While she was pregnant with their 11th, he kicked her and broke her back while they were outside in the middle of winter. He went inside and left her lying out there all night. The baby was born during the night and froze to death. Mary was bedridden for the rest of her life. Mike took this opportunity to begin sexually abusing 6 of their daughters. The 2 oldest were already grown and had left home, and the youngest was just a baby. This went on for 4 years until he decided the youngest was old enough to start on. One of the other girls, 19-year-old Ida, stepped in to defend her. He told Ida that she could save her sister by satisfying him herself. Afterward, Ida told her mother, who refused to believe it and slapped her. Mike punished Ida for telling by making her brother and sisters each stab her one time. Anon had heard about a local farmer with a crippled wife and 7 children. By this time the 3rd oldest girl had left and decided she should go out and see if there was anything she could do to help them out. She visited while Ida was still recovering from being stabbed and noticed that the children were very clearly being abused. She helped all the girls who were being raped get away by finding them jobs that offered room and board, leaving only the boy and youngest girl. In retaliation, Mike had the nun murdered and the body dumped in the river. My Gigi grandma tried to tell people her father was behind the disappearance, but he was well connected and admired. He was an extremely talented musician and knew Ulysses S. Grant personally, and she was just a 9-year-old girl, and nobody would listen to her. All of this was kept quiet because it was embarrassing and scandalous. Most of the siblings never told anyone. Ida explained the scars to her husband and children by saying she had had surgery for tumors. Very few know the truth. Great-grandfather owned large farm in Alabama. He was like 6'6" and hugely muscled and fit. He allowed black families that worked for him to live in houses on his property. He was strict old school German, but tried to be fair as long as there was mutual respect. You took care of the property you lived in, and you worked when you were supposed to work. He worked multiple wives to death. He tried to take care of the people that worked for him. Very often he'd pay the male workers, and they'd run out and blow all their pay instantly gambling and drinking and raising hell, and he'd go retrieve them from the local jail on a regular basis. The guys would blow all the family's money on themselves, so he'd often provide supplies and food for the families and deduct from their wages before giving them cash at cost. My dad had to live with him 1 year when his dad lost his arm in an accident. My dad accidentally fell off a horse and broke his arm. His grandfather beat him badly for being clumsy before he'd call the doctor to fix it. One winter he noticed some of his fence posts missing and cattle roaming around free, and found out one of the workers was drunk and cold, and rather than look for firewood he stole the posts. He beat him to death in front of his place for being a lazy thief and told the family to get off his property. Another time someone had damaged some equipment, so he lined up the workers to find out who did it. My dad saw this while staying there. One of the workers, obviously the guy who did it, mouthed off and said a few pleasant things then bowed up at him. He reached out calmly and broke the guy's neck like it was nothing. Then he told the others to get back to work and to be more careful. Afterward he just called the sheriff to come get the body and told him what happened. Simple murders like that were considered justified, so there was no need to involve the courts. Totally different time and world. Obviously a lot more had happened, but my dad, who was a big man himself and hard as nails his entire life, never ever talked about him. And when he did, you could still hear the fear in his voice, like he was talking about the devil. My great-grandfather was a paranoid schizophrenic, supposedly. Had to drop out of school in the 20s to raise his crazy mother, so he grew to hate all women, and in the 30s ended up marrying my great-grandmother, who was like 14 at the time. I'll spare the details, but after children he grew more and more sexist, to where he thought my great-grandmother was literally scum, and therefore more and more abusive. There's a story somewhere before this of my great-grandmother being so terrified for her life she took the giant teddy bear their daughter won at the fair and sewed his shotgun into the bear so he'd never find it. Turns out that wasn't his only gun. One day he called for a family meeting. Had my great-grandmother and all four of their children, roughly middle school slash young high school age at this point, all come into the living room, where he started ranting about things that didn't make sense. Proceeded to shoot my great-grandmother slash his wife, and then himself in the head in front of all their children. My great-grandmother pulled through, but the doctor said, if the bullet had went an even half an inch over, she would have been permanently paralyzed. She " had severe back problems ever since. Took years to get this full story out. Y'all are the first to hear it outside the family. Also noteworthy, back then they had no sort of cleaning arrangements for situations like that, so not only did their children witness that, but they had to scrub their father's blood and brains off the walls afterwards. So yeah, that's our dirty secret. This will probably be buried, but here goes. Context: I'm female and 9 years younger than my sister, so I only lived through the aftermath of this, and was told many of the details as I became old enough to understand them. My father molested my half-sister, different dads, from when she was very young until she was a mid-teenager. When it finally came to the surface, it turned into a he said slash she said type of situation, in terms of police being able to prosecute. My sister, in an attempt to prove she wasn't lying, caught an instance on tape and was going to bring it to the police. Here's where it gets worse. My father was the breadwinner for our family of 6. My mother was terrified of us ending up homeless or having our futures ruined by having a father in jail. When she found out about the tape, instead of turning it into law enforcement, she chose to burn it instead. My parents did separate, and the molestations obviously stopped, as my mom would not let him come near my sister again, but he was never prosecuted or charged with anything that would put him on a sex offenders list. Instead, the whole situation was covered up, and it was explained to the younger kids, myself included, that my father was a sex addict. Yeah, no. Because that's nicer than pedophile. Us kids were also told to never speak about this to anyone. It's a family issue, no one needs to know. This left a lasting trauma that I only recently began to mend. My parents are still married and living the luxurious retired life. I have low contact with them for a variety of reasons, only one of which is the above. My sister, who is now living a happy and healthy life raising a family of her own, has zero contact with my mother. For the record, and because I'm sure people will be curious, I was never touched or mistreated a single time by my father. I have a conflicted stance about all of this, because he's been nothing but a decent man to me personally. That obviously doesn't excuse the horrid things he has done, but when I work out how to handle that with my therapist, I'll get back to you. Super late to the comments, but here goes. My father-in-law, we can call him Juan, has a history of abusing people. Specifically my mother-in-law, call her Laura, and her 2 children. Fast forward a few years, Juan is on all kinds of pain meds for a neck surgery he had and has become dependent upon them. He becomes more unstable and abusive with time. Juan, in an attempt to stop Laura from leaving, researches how many of X meds it will take to almost kill him, and does so, making a show of how he can't live without Laura. Suicide attempts and a multitude of other events take place over the next 10 to 15 years. Eventually my mother-in-law gets divorced from him and leaves with the 2 children. My wife was 15 at the time and her brother was 13-ish. Now, Juan's parents absolutely refuse to believe their wonderful child could ever be less than perfect, completely blaming Laura for all of Juan's issues. Juan immediately proceeds to move back home with mommy and daddy, and still does to this day at 42 years old. No rent, no job since years before the divorce, just bumming it perpetually, the victim milking disability. My brother-in-law, Todd, has been bouncing back and forth between the two of his parents for years, preferring Juan because Juan will use his disability checks to bribe him to hang around. Despite Laura being a wonderful woman who is doing her best to raise him right with her new husband, who is also an amazing person. So, hanging out with Juan is a bad influence. Underage drinking being the biggest issue that Juan allows, because he takes care of him more than Laura does, and he is 18 and old enough to make choices. The abuse continues with Juan being a terrible father to Todd and my wife, even though we live 8 hours away from him. He calls us over and over, leaves dozens of texts and voicemails. Constant harassment. The first text is an apology for being a jerk, and they then proceed to become hateful. I should have had Laura get an abortion with you. You're a terrible wife. Bullshit. Blah blah blah. Guy is a real gem and I personally think he is bipolar as fuck. Todd, at the time living with Juan, has a birthday and calls my wife hysterical, barely able to speak. After maybe an hour of calming him down, he tells my wife that Juan got him drunk and raped him. The inflections in his voice and the way he sobbed told me all I needed to know. He was telling the truth and there was no doubt. So, we tell Laura, who is shocked, and offers to fly Todd across the country to live with her, and he is more than willing. Well, it gets back to Juan that we know, so he proceeds to text and call both of us relentlessly. We block his number. He gets a new number and does it again. So, he finally leaves a message about how Todd was seducing him, and he couldn't be responsible for what he did while drunk. As well as, Todd was drunk, he is to blame. I feel violated. Bullshit and harassment. Multiple blocked phone numbers, etc. So, here we are almost a year later. My wife and I have a 3-month-old boy, and Juan wants to be a part of our life and his grandson. Todd is getting therapy and still living with his mom and stepdad. Juan's parents completely refuse to believe that he would ever do anything like that, and, obviously, Todd seduced Juan. Our Juan would never do anything so terrible. So, we excommunicate Juan's parents, who now have become hateful and harassed us until we block their phones as well. So, that's my family shit. Ta-da. So, story time. Last November I did a 23andMe test. A few days ago, I decided to peruse through the results again. I noticed a section of the results I hadn't before, possible DNA relatives. So I clicked on it, and it told me I had 8 possible half-siblings, which at first I thought was just a glitch. As far as I knew, my parents had no other children and my parents were indeed my parents. So, curious about this, I decided to message some of my half-siblings. One of them found me on Facebook and reached out. She told me that we shared a father, that we had been conceived via a sperm donor. I was absolutely confused and assumed that this all must be some big mistake. I reached out to my mom, and she was at first beating around the bush, trying to deny the issue. But as I spoke with my half-siblings, the facts became too undeniable. My mom has always told me she had trouble conceiving me. If this were a glitch with 23andMe, there's no way it would connected me with the late half-siblings. Scrolling through pictures of my half-siblings, I realized I resembled them, and reconsidering my 23andMe results, they did not line up with my dad's heritage. I called my mom, telling her this was undeniable, and that I wasn't angry. She fessed up and told me that they had mixed donor sperm with my father's, and she was never sure which had taken. The man I called my father died when I was 19, so I can't hear his opinion on the matter. But turns out my biological father is still well and alive, which is a complete mindfuck. I also have 18 half-siblings scattered about the earth. 19 including my younger sister, who I always thought was my full sister. I'm still processing all this, and I'm just shocked. Nothing has changed, but everything's changed. As told by my mother, my great-great-grandfather came from a family of some substance in rural West Virginia. He was educated and became, for a time, a schoolmaster. He fell in love and married a student much younger than he was, 15 years old or so I believe, and who was disapproved of by the family, for cause as it happens. She came from a much poorer family, and, given subsequent events I have heard relatives say she had an evil streak. My great-great-grandfather was disinherited following the wedding and became poor, though he did own property for farming. Somehow, and it has been suggested to me, it was by means of fraud and scheming on the part of his brothers and father, my great-great-grandfather ended up in an insane asylum, where he quickly became ill and died and on the grounds of which he is buried. I have seen the grave and records for his involuntary commitment at the behest of his brothers and father, so I know that this much is true, though the rest I have only from the testimony of relatives. Sometime during his confinement, or after his death, his wife abandoned her young children. There were four and the youngest, Jack, was an infant, on the family farm. For this she is not fondly remembered in the family, but I wonder if perhaps she was not as evil as family memory holds her to be. By all accounts she was only in her early 20s, on a farm far from home, or help which she probably could not work alone, with four children she was too poor to support. It was wrong no doubt to abandon them, but perhaps more an act of panic or despair or escape than heartlessly evil as the family tells it. Though who can know the motives of people so long dead? The children lived alone for some period of time, before being discovered by a traveling salesman who brought them to the attention of the authorities. After this the oldest son, my great-grandfather, Robert, was adopted by his mother's family who I'm told wanted him as a laborer, and who rejected his two less useful sisters and infant brother. The two sisters were adopted by other families. The baby brother was actually adopted by a relative on his father's side. Many years passed, and Robert became a man who left to fight in the Second World War. By this point he had lost contact with his siblings, but managed to find his oldest sister and communicate with her over the mail. Though they had not seen each other since they were children, he sent much of the money he was paid during the war to her for safekeeping, and, I'm told, to keep it out of the possession of his mother's family who he distrusted. When the war ended, Robert returned, found his oldest sister, and together they set out with his war savings to try and find their two lost siblings. Eventually they found their little sister and reconnected with her. Alas, not so with the baby brother. They learned that during the years of separation he had fallen from his horse while playing polo, broken his neck or back, and died. Robert settled in Ohio, bought farmland my great-uncle still owns, built a house that, though now a ruin, we still visit on occasion, and had six children. Posting like 10 hours too late, but fuck it. My grandfather was a WWII veteran. He landed on Normandy plus 14 as a paratrooper then. I'm hazy on the details. This story is 10 years old from when I heard it, and I'm quite a few drinks in. Fought to Berlin. The man was known to drink and gamble, but never disastrously so. He was the guy that loaded ammo and carried the stand for the Browning .30 calories. He met the Russians on the river. He was a battle-hardened man and taught his children about the terrors of war. He became staunchly anti-war and preached the horrors to his children. After the war he became a trucker, driving cross-country to deliver various goods. As per such, he had to join the union, this being the Teamsters. Due to the nefarious history of the Teamsters and their ongoing ties to various criminal enterprises, he was against them, and very outspoken of it. Evidently the unionists were relaying this outspoken behavior of the nature of his dissatisfaction to leadership. He was seen as not a good egg in the basket. My grandfather was found clubbed to death in the 80s on the side of the road. His truck had all goods inside of it. His wallet had no cash missing. Everything was there. He was murdered, not robbed. Police reports corroborated this. I never got to meet my grandfather. He died over a decade before I was born. The family immediately points the blame at the Teamsters. Not sure if it's true, but based on the anecdotal evidence I have heard, with zero counterpoints, to be fair, has me convinced. I don't really think that this is a dark secret, but it's something that I didn't find out until I was an adult, which was mostly because my grandma doesn't like talking about it, so I think it counts. When I was going through some old stuff of my grandma's after the death of my mother, I found some old photographs of a baby, not my mom, because my mom had dark, almost black, hair at birth and this baby was blonde, and a birth certificate for someone named Francesco, mom's maiden name. I asked my grandma about it, and at first she didn't really want to tell me, but I gave her some space and she must have decided that I deserved to know, or maybe she was just tired of having the secret, because she eventually told me. Francesco, who they called Frank, was my grandma's son. He was my mom's younger brother by a couple of years. Apparently, when Frank was 3, my grandma's ex-husband kidnapped him, and my grandma never saw him again. My grandma's ex-husband, my grandfather, although I don't consider him such, the least reason for witches, because I never met him, was involved with a mob and it's suspected that he took Frank with him back to Sicily, but nobody is really sure. My grandma is pretty sure that he would have taken my mom too, if my mom hadn't been sick and in the hospital due to tonsillitis at the time. It's kind of given me an idea of why that side of my family can be kind of withholding about things. I didn't know my mom had been married before my dad until I was a teenager, but it also makes me feel really, really sorry for my grandma. Thank you so much for watching the whole video. Please leave a like and subscribe.